In this video, we continue our study of the symmetries of a square. So what we want to understand is how to compose two symmetries. What that means is, what if we were to do a symmetry to the square, we apply the symmetry, and then we immediately follow it by another symmetry. Let's take the square here, and let's first apply vertical reflection, right? So we reflect about this vertical axis, right? So we pick it up, and we get that, right? So we started in the original position, we applied the vertical reflection, and we now get this. So now suppose we immediately follow this with horizontal reflection. So now we don't go back to the beginning. We're staying where we are, and now we apply horizontal reflection, right? Still this line right here, and we get this, right? And so the question is, look at this configuration. What we can ask is, starting from the original position, right, remember kind of our original configuration, how can we make the square look like this by applying just one symmetry instead of two? So it may not immediately be obvious, how could we get this just from starting? Remember, this was our original position. And so the question is, starting from here, what we did is we applied a vertical reflection and then a horizontal reflection. So how could we have gotten to this point just from our original starting position? So the first thing it's going to be helpful to do is to think about what our symmetries do to our square, right? So we've talked about the different symmetries, the rotations, the reflections, but one thing that I mentioned in the last video was the symmetry is really determined by what it does to the square, namely, what's the end result? That's what we care about. And so it will be useful for each of our eight symmetries to not just understand how to move the square, but what it looks like once it's actually been done. So for example, whenever you think of the identity, you should think, this is the end result, right? Or what if we do clockwise rotation by 90 degrees. Right. There's clockwise rotation. Right. And so what really matters is where these numbers now are, right? And that's because all the symmetries that we're dealing with here are what are called rigid motions, right? Remember, a rigid motion is a transformation that preserves distance and therefore preserves the size and shape of an object. So in particular, because these rigid motions preserve distances, it suffices to just know where these vertices move. Once we know where the vertices move, because the rigid motion preserves distances, every other point is determined once you know where they move. Right? So namely, the only thing that we really need to know is how are these labels on the corners changing. So that's why we labeled them in the way that we did, is because in order to understand a symmetry, all we need to know is the end result of the symmetry, and to know the end result, all we have to do is see where the labels now are. And so what we want to do is for each of the possible eight symmetries, we want to see what the end result is, right, and record what it looks like. So for 90 degree clockwise rotation, it looks like that. That's the end result. For 180 degree clockwise rotation, this is the end result, right? And now here is clockwise rotation by 270 degrees. This is what we call R3. That's clockwise rotation by 270 degrees. Now let's return to the starting point. Here is reflection about the axis H. Let's return. Here is reflection about the axis V. here is reflection about the axis D1. And finally, here is reflection about the axis D2. So now here are all the end results of the 8 symmetries. So remember that for these to be the end results of the symmetries, you always need to start from that initial position. If we had started from a different position than this, then the end result of the symmetries would also look different.
Okay, so now suppose that we want to compose two symmetries. We want to do that, those two symmetries that I talked about earlier. We want to do the vertical reflection and now a horizontal reflection. So we do the vertical reflection like this, and now we do the horizontal reflection, and now we can ask, what is that? We want to think of those two symmetries as just one symmetry. How could I get from my starting point to this through just one symmetry? Well, if you look at this pattern, three here, four here, two here, one here, you can ask, which one of the 8 symmetries does it match? The square has only 8 symmetries. This must be one of them. Which one does it match? You know, we did a vertical reflection and a horizontal reflection. Forget how we got here. Just look at the end result and say, what does that match? And if you look at your list, you'll see that the only possibility is R squared. This matches R squared. And so therefore, if we start here and we do a vertical reflection and a horizontal reflection, we get the same thing as if we just did clockwise rotation by 180 degrees. So that's the point. So composing the symmetry V times H gives us R squared. That's the point. So that's where algebra starts coming in, is that by composing, we have this operation of composing where we do one symmetry followed immediately by another symmetry. And in this case, we see it's the same thing as 180 degree clockwise rotation, or what we've chosen to call R squared. So that's what we want to do. We want to do this for all possible combinations. We want to fill out the group, the multiplication table or group table for the symmetries of the square. So there are 64 possible combinations, right? Because there's 8 elements, right, in the group. And so you can think, you can start with any of the 8 elements to begin with, followed by any of the other 8 symmetries. And so the total number of combinations, by the fundamental principle of counting, is 8 times 8, or 64. Now, many of these won't be too difficult to do. For example, suppose I want to compose the identity with H. So let's do the identity with H. So first I do the identity, and now I do H. What does that look like? Just H, right? So if I do the identity, then H, I just get H back, which should make sense, right? The identity means do nothing. If I do nothing and then I do horizontal reflection, then what have I done altogether? I've done horizontal reflection, and that's it, right? So some of the possible combinations are easy to figure out because they involve the identity. Some others are easy to do because they involve a reflection applied twice. So suppose I want to figure out H squared. Namely, I'm going to do horizontal reflection, and then I'm going to do horizontal reflection again a second time. So let's do horizontal reflection, and now let's do horizontal reflection again. So notice I'm back to the beginning. What does this look like? Namely, how do I get to this endpoint from where I started? Well, I just apply the identity, right? So this is a way of saying that if I do the horizontal reflection twice in a row, I get back the identity symmetry. So H squared equals the identity, right? This comes from the fact that reflections have the property that when you do them twice, you always get back to the identity, right? No matter which reflection you do. Here I did H twice, I got back to the identity. If I had done V twice, so here's V,
and here's V again. I get back to the identity. Right. So now it's important to notice that the order in which you do symmetries makes a big difference to your final answer. Namely, this group is not what you could call commutative. Namely, when you do, for example, two symmetries in a row, it makes a difference which one you start with. So to illustrate that, let's look at R times V. Namely, I'm going to look at what's called 90 degree clockwise rotation followed by reflection across the vertical axis and see what the result is. And then I'm going to switch the order. Namely, I'm going to do reflection across the vertical axis and then 90 degree clockwise rotation, and I'm going to compare the two answers. So let's first do RV. So first of all, I'm going to rotate by 90 degrees clockwise. That's what I get. And now I'm going to reflect across the vertical axis. That gives me that. And so now I can look, this is a symmetry, right? And so it's one of the eight, so I can look at my eight possible symmetries and see which one has the same end result as this. And upon doing that, I can see that's D2, right? Diagonal reflection across the axis D2. So now, let's do the other way. So let's go back to our starting position. Now let's do the other order. I'm going to do V times R. So I'm going to do reflection across the vertical axis followed by 90 degree clockwise rotation. So reflection across the vertical axis. Now 90 degree clockwise rotation. And you see I get a different answer. Right? It doesn't match with what I had before. The numbers are in different places, the labels. And so if I look at my list of eight symmetries to see which one matches this, I can see that this one matches D1, reflection across the diagonal axis called D1. Right? And so we see in this case that R times V gave us D2, whereas V times R gave us D1. So it's very important to notice this is what we call non-commutative. This means that the order in which you do you're doing this operation of composing symmetries, the order in which you compose two elements makes a different, gives you a different answer. This is unusual compared to other operations we're used to, like addition and ordinary addition and multiplication of numbers. In that case, when you add two numbers, it doesn't make any difference which order you add them in. 2 + 3 is the same as 3 + 2. But in this case, composing symmetries, it does make a difference. R times V is not the same as V times R.